Very well. Now we are going to enter the topic of equilibrium carrier concentration. By equilibrium, we mean that the carriers are not moving. Okay? So let's enter into the calculation of numbers n and p, the number of electrons and the number of holes, respectively. Entonces vamos a pasar a la discusión sobre la concentración de portadores en equilibrio, es decir, que pues, no se mueven. Y de ahí el primer tema sería el cálculo de n y p, es decir, número de electrones y número de huecos, respectivamente. So, let's introduce variable GC, or actually remember variable GC. GC is the density of states. Then F of capital E is the Fermi distribution, and dE is the differential of energy. The product of these three quantities gives the number of electrons in the conduction band per cubic centimeter in the region between some energy level and the same energy plus an energy differential. Entonces, recordemos que GDC es la densidad de estados. Cuando la multiplicamos por la distribución de Fermi y por un diferencial de energía, lo que tenemos es el número de electrones en la banda de conducción por centímetro cúbico, por volumen, en una región que abarca de E a E más un diferencial de energía. Now, let's integrate this product, and when we integrate, what we will get is the total number of electrons in the conduction band. Okay? Total integral. And the integral looks like this. Look, that is the same quantity. GC of E, of course, times the Fermi distribution times the differential of energy. Actually, just to make this more clear, here this density of states must be a function, please, of energy. We hence integrate from the conduction band to the top of the conduction band. Okay? That will give us the number of electrons. And for holes, it will be the same thing. Just that we're going to integrate from the bottom of the energy levels. Remember that energy, this is EC, EB, down here we have E bottom, and here we have E top. But we never draw these two extra lines, E top and E bottom, because it's not necessary. But when we are doing the integral, we need the lower and upper, on the top and yeah, the lower and upper limits. So those are going to be the limits. These two in the case of holes. And again, we use the density of states for holes. The distribution is 1 minus the Fermi distribution. Remember that a probability distribution must be 1, that's why it's 1 minus, and the energy differential. Entonces, integramos nuestra expresión GC en función de E en función, por la probabilidad que nos da la distribución de Fermi por el diferencial. La integral nos queda como está aquí. Y esa integral nos da el número total de electrones en la banda de conducción, en el caso de que sea GC, y pues la integral queda como se ve ahí. El límite inferior es SE, el límite inferior es ETOP, que es el diagrama de bandas completo, pero nosotros siempre omitimos ETOP. En el caso de los huecos, en vez de GC, ponemos GB, ¿verdad? Porque estamos hablando de huecos, es decir, de la banda de valencia. Esta. Y la integral sería desde E-bottom, pero nunca la ponemos porque no es necesario. Sabemos que abajo está E, bueno, E-bottom o E-bottom, como quieran decir. Y ese va a ser nuestro intervalo de integración. E-bottom va abajo, EV, la de valencia, la banda de valencia va arriba. La expresión es la misma, nada más que es GB, la distribución de Fermi, aquí lo escribí mal, ¿verdad? Si no se debe poner. Ah, no, no, perdón, sí, falso. Esa, ¿qué hice? Esto de aquí es en función de la energía, ¿verdad? Discúlpenme. Esta de aquí es la probabilidad que da la distribución de Fermi. Pero esta es la de los electrones y esta va a ser la de los holes. Recuerden que debe valer 1, ¿verdad? 1 menos sería 1 menos la de los electrones. Esa es la de los huecos. Claro, por DE, para tener una integral completa, ¿se acuerdan? Esto debe ir al principio y esto, en teoría, al final. Aunque como es una multiplicación, nosotros lo podemos habitualmente mover de lugar. Bueno, vamos a sustituir la GCE. Ya la sustituimos aquí, miren. Eso es lo que vale, está en un video anterior. Es, bueno, los límites de integración, pues ya ven que son los mismos, ¿no? Sustituimos entonces la densidad de estados para la banda de conducción para los electrones. Más efectiva. Esta diferencia entre la energía, porque depende de la energía, ¿verdad? Miren, depende de la energía. No es una multiplicación, por favor, de la energía con respecto a la banda de conducción. Después se está multiplicando por la distribución de Fermi, que es esto que está abajo. Es 1 sobre, pero el 1 nunca se pone. Y luego se multiplica por DE, que aquí está el DE. ¿Ok? Sigue. So, we are going to rewrite this expression by doing the corresponding substitutions. Here is the density of states. It's being rewritten here. We have effective mass. The difference between the actual energy, remember that is a function of energy, minus the conduction band energy, and so forth. All of that is the density of states. Remember that we have pi in the denominator, pi squared times h bar to the third. Then the Fermi distribution, which is all of these. 1 goes on top, and then the differential, which is here, right? We proceed to make some simplifications. That means taking out of the integral all of the constants. Remember that only E is a variable. That's the variable that we are integrating. So everything else is a constant. That's why we can take out, for instance, the effective masses, the number 2, the pi, the h bar, which because they're constants. However, we cannot take out the square root. We cannot take out e because e has the Euler number, has as an exponent e, and the denominator of the whole thing has capital E, with the energy, I mean, and that's a variable, okay? Entonces, simplificamos la expresión que ya teníamos, sacamos las constantes, como las más efectivas, como pi, como h barra, pero dentro de la integral se deben quedar la e, que es la variable de integración, la e mayúscula, la energía. Entonces, se queda la raíz y se queda el denominador porque tiene e a la e, ¿verdad? En un exponente. Now, we introduce all of these constants with that funny Greek letter, which I can't remember its name, but it looks like that. So, in a moment, I will remember the name. Well, that I remember is actually not true. I'm going to look up for the name. Vamos a introducir esas constantes. Y ahorita busco cómo se llama esa constante. Ahorita me acuerdo. Ahorita la encuentro. ¡Ah! Google, no me hagas esto. Sálvame. Esa letra chistosa que está ahí, según es una letra griega. Pero puede ser que no lo sea. Como, ah, sí, como no. Esa es una eta, claro. Eta. Así como el coche, pero sin la J y con una sola T. Eta. That's an eta or eta. I don't know how you pronounce it in English, but it's called eta. So, we say it in English, probably eta. I think it's eta, I guess. Eta equals E energy minus EC divided by KT. Then eta C equals the Fermi energy minus the conduction band energy over KT. The derivative of that, well, you can derivate in reference to dE, please. And then we can also introduce this difference, which is all of these, and that you can clearly see that the conduction band cancels out. Easy. Well, by knowing this, we will use all of these constants to simplify the expressions for n and for p. All right? So, for n, the expression for n is here. And the expression for n is here as well. The constant outside remains. Okay? But the e minus EC is here. Okay? It's eta. Okay. So, it's written here with the corresponding KT no longer being in the denominator, but being in the numerator because of the so famous sandwich law. Okay. Now, that way it can cancel out and go back to being the same. Now, from this expression, you can solve for dE. And you can see that d equals d eta times kt. So that's this expression here. In the denominator, 1 is 1. E to the E minus EC. E minus EC. Oh, it's again this one. Right? E minus EC over KT. Perfect. This is exactly theta. Sorry, eta. The change colors to pink. And we are subtracting EC. What is that? EC. Oh, no. Sorry. Let me go back. We have something even better. Well, the one was okay. But we have an expression for eta minus eta c, which is here, and that is e minus ef wait a second, I did something wrong, I'm pretty sure of that. That is E minus IC minus EF plus EC. Okay, E minus EC. So what we have here, oh my God, is that this expression here, E minus EC divided by KT, is now but it didn't work. It's supposed to work. It's now, let's redo this equation because I'm sure I did it wrong. Wait a second. Because I already did this one. So, eta minus eta c. So, it's supposed to be e minus ec minus ef plus ec. Eta c. That's the definition of eta c, if I remember correctly. Let me just quickly check. Quickly. What am I? Okay, yep. Okay, yeah. So this is divided by KT. So effectively, these do cancel out. I know where the mistake is. Sorry. Here, you see with breath, we have 1 E minus EF. Here is an F. Sorry about that confusion. So, if this is E minus EF over KT, and this is E minus EF over KT, so all of this expression can be substituted by all of this expression, which is here. Okay? Finally, de lower limit and upper limit says the following. Says that when we substitute the conduction band, okay, in eta, the conduction band in eta, when we do that substitution, that goes to zero, and etop eta becomes infinite. Now, what does it mean? Well, that's quite simple. Let's look at this equation. When we calculate this expression here and we substitute E by EC, well, EC minus EC equals zero, right? That's why we get D zero. What happens, however, when E is E top? So E is, this line is actually up here. So this distance is very large. So it is so large that we say that this number approaches infinite. That's why this expression for n becomes this expression for n. So let's see. First, we are going to take kt, which are constants, and we are going to take them out of the integral. Okay, so we take them out. But here is another kt. So we're going to take kt out. This kt, the second, is a, it's to the first power, or you can also say that it's to the 2 over 2. Plus that, because they're multiplying, it comes out as 3 over 2. Okay? Remember that this one, this eta, is still power to the 1 half. That's why it remains eta to the 1 half. This derivative of, or differential of eta, remains inside the integral. The denominator doesn't change. Here the new limit, 0 to infinite. So this result here is the whole expression for n, which is very large. But that is, let's say, the exact formula to calculate the carrier concentration in equilibrium. All right? It involves the effective masses, temperature, and of course eta, which is nothing but energy, right? And again, temperature and the conduction band in the case of electrons. Now, that formula that we just wrote is horrible. We're going to define some other formulas. We're going to define what is called the Fermi-Dirac integral of order 1 half, which is here. That's a definition. So you just look and that's how it is defined. We're going to define something called the effective density of conduction band states. which is that quantity that you see here. And the same for the effective density of valence band states, which again is that. When you substitute these three constants, because they're constants, you see? NC and MV, I mean. The Fermi Dirac integral, that is actually a function, okay? Because it has a function, look, here. When you substitute these three and you put them into the equation down below, that equation simplifies to the equations that are or were in blue and red, okay? And if we calculate those equations at 300 Kelvin, we get that number. For the conduction and the valence band, we get 2.51 times 10 to the 19 per cubic centimeter times the effective mass of either electrons or holes divided by the rest mass, effective as well, to the 3/2. This works at 300 Kelvin, okay? Remember that those quantities are called the effective density of conduction band states, please. But there is more to come. I think, yep. Wait a second, something happened here. These numbers. And inside the boxes, you can see that you can calculate what we wanted to calculate. We wanted to calculate the carrier concentration. So we can calculate lowercase n and lowercase p, the number of electrons and the number of holes, with very simple formulas. NC and MV are here, 2 over pi, which is quite simple, and the Fermi Dirac integral of order 1/2, eta C, which formula is here. That integral is not that bad, okay? Well, next. Sorry. What happens when the Fermi energy is much less than the conduction band minus 3 kT? Remember that kT is something like the room temperature. Well, look at the diagram. When the Fermi energy is in this range, the distance is not more than 3 kT, if it does not exceed, no es más grande than 3 kT, then we are talking about a non-degenerate semiconductor. Okay? The same happens for the valence band. If this distance does not exceed 3 KT, we are talking a non-degenerate semiconductor. Okay. And that allows to find or to use a value for the Fermi Dirac integral of order 1/2 that is calculated quite easily, is here, okay? And that leaves us with formulas for the number of electrons and number of holes in equilibrium that is just that, okay? So they're even more simple. When the distance exceeds 3 KT, we are talking about a degenerate semiconductor. We use degenerate, that word, to mean highly doped. It is sort of the same. So, it's not exactly the same, but in reality, in practice, we use these terms as if they were the same. Degenerate means that we highly dope our semiconductor. All right. So I can remember when I stopped speaking in Spanish. So I hope it was around here. Probably. Let's say it was here. Entonces, definimos esas tres cosas que están ahí. La integral de Fermi-Dirac de orden 1/2 es una función. Entonces, pues les va a dar diferentes valores dependiendo de cuánto vale eta c. Definimos nc como la densidad efectiva de los estados en la banda de conducción y nv como la densidad efectiva de los estados de la banda de valencia. Son definiciones, las dos, la segunda y la tercera, y la primera es también una definición, pero eso es una integral. Con eso podemos sacar las fórmulas que están en verde y en rojo, que nos dan el número de electrones y huecos. Se dan cuenta, ya están un poquito más decentes que la horrible esta de aquí, ¿no? Bueno. NC y NV se pueden calcular mucho más fácil porque son puras constantes. Lo único que necesitamos conocer es la masa efectiva, tanto de electrones huecos y en reposo. ¿Ok? ¿Por qué no está calculado? Porque depende de qué semiconductor estemos ocupando, ¿no? Puede ser silicio, germanio, arsenuro de galio, etcétera, ¿no? Indium arsenide, INAS. Etcétera. Bueno. Si estamos en un caso todavía más particular, que es que la distancia entre la banda de conducción y el nivel de Fermi no sea mayor a 3 KT, o lo mismo, que la distancia entre la banda de valencia y el nivel de Fermi no sea mayor que KT, estamos en el régimen de no degeneración y nos permite utilizar estas fórmulas de aquí para la integral de Fermi-Dirac de orden 1/2, son mucho más, que ya son muy fáciles de ocupar, y por lo tanto podemos calcular n y podemos calcular p, número de electrones, número de huecos, de una forma bien bien fácil. Si nos pasamos del 3KT, estamos hablando de un semiconductor degenerado. Creo que así se dice, ¿eh? O lo que es prácticamente lo mismo, o así se entiende, un semiconductor que está altamente dopado. ¿Ok? Y por el momento le paramos aquí. So we stop here.